So today, I'm really happy. We have Lenore Skenazy here. Is that how to say
it? It's absolutely right. Yep.
Okay. The topic of her talk, the title of her talk is Raising Kids Without Fear and Hysteria. I made up that title.
I love it. I was thinking that's not the title of my talk, but I like it.
Right. Lenore is a nationally syndicated columnist and author. I think she became involved in this subject because she wrote a column.
Oh, don't talk about this. Just tell she's America's worst mom. That's all they have to
she's
know.
She's America's worst mom. But let me just very quickly. She wrote a column describing her decision to let her 9-year-old son take the New York City home alone. This column unleashed a flood of reactions, ranging from accusations of child abuse to memories of childhood freedom and the first-time subway trips. The story was nationally and internationally covered. She was on the Today Show, Fox News, MSNBC, and she became known as America's Worst Mom. Anyway, she's going to talk about that today. Her column appears in many newspapers. She worked for the New York Sun and the New York Daily News, NPR, and Mad Magazine. She's the author of the book Free Range Kids, Giving Our Children the Freedom We Had Without Going Nuts with Worry. And she can talk. Also, she's a 1981 graduate of Yale University.
And the reason she knows is because her husband was a 1981 graduate.
He was in her class.
And we were together. So, not that it's completely nepotism here and she only invites friends of the family. But I do want to thank you, Emily, for inviting me here. And what a cool thing that everybody gets to come to this lecture series. And there's cookies. I'm here possibly because if you Google America's Worst Mom, you will find me for 11 million hits. But after that comes America's Worst Mother's Day Gifts. And I figure I should let you know because I researched them myself. You don't want to get a mom a McDonald's gift card, lingerie, that's for Father's Day, okay, and the other thing is a Three Stooges DVD. These constitute terrible Mother's Day presents, and now you know. Terrible mother, America's worst or not, I'm a mom, and that means that I spend a lot of my time talking to other moms. That's what you do. I'm sure you all remember this, and some of you will be part of that scene soon. It's kind of cool with the two different age groups. So a few years ago, I was talking to my neighbor, and she was livid. She was so upset. She was going, Lenore, can you believe she did that? And I'm like, what, Melissa? Did what? And Melissa had been at Costco, I think the one in Brooklyn. She was there with her children, her daughters, who were at the time ages 5 and 2. And she was waiting in line, you know, the endless, endless Costco line. And the lady behind her tapped her on the shoulder and said, excuse me, would you mind watching my baby for a minute? I forgot, tuna for Armageddon. You know, everything there is in these giant pallets. So Melissa said, sure, she would watch. She was a little boy in the cart. And off went the lady to, you know, aisle 5,738. And that's what Melissa was talking to me about. She said, can you believe she did that? And I'm like, forgot the tuna? You know, it's impossible to remember anything at Costco. It's all those brown paper packages. And she said, no, Lenore. I could have taken her baby and she would never have seen him again. Too loud. I'm going to talk like this because this will allow me to walk. Okay? And walk and talk. And I can talk really loud because I'm a New Yorker and I talk on the subway. So she felt like the woman had been wrong because Melissa said, I could have taken her baby while she was off getting the tuna, and she would never have seen him again. And I'm like, whoa, Melissa, that's what you think she did that was wrong? Let's just go through this logically for a few minutes here and figure out what would it take for that scenario to be likely, okay? First of all, Melissa herself would have had to have been a baby-snatching kidnapper, okay? Who used the rather low-yield strategy of waiting in public for a baby to be handed to her, right? And she's one of the rare ones that has 2 children of her own already and just wanted a third to, like, complete the set. Say that was Melissa's nefarious scheme, and finally she got this baby handed to her. So now she has to, get the baby sort of out of the cart, right, pulling him by those chubby little legs, and they're scraping the cart. And then she has to hold on to her own 2-year-old and get her 5-year-old to come with her, and then they have to go by all the other people, excuse me, excuse me, excuse me. She has to leave her groceries.
She has to leave her place in line at Costco. What kind of crazy person? That's an hour she will never get back, right? That line in Costco, and she's going, bye, everyone, excuse me, I'm sorry, okay, and going past the cashier, never mind us, and the two little kids of her own are screaming like, Mommy, what about our goldfish crackers? We were supposed to have those gold, that palette. And the little one is going, Mommy, why are you stealing that lady's baby? Aren't I your baby? I don't want a little brother. I don't want a little brother. Shut up, kid, we gotta go. So you're going by everybody, and then you get to the door. And you know, who's at the door at Costco? It's the lady who checks your receipt. To see, let's see, do you have anything in here that you didn't pay for? Anything that doesn't belong to you? Yes, we've got that lady's baby. Mommy's taking the baby and I'm the baby. Shut up, kid. So you get to the great door and it opens wide and you're facing the parking lot. And, you know, Melissa's a little nervous. It's her first felony. And so she's looking around, where'd I park the car? Where'd I park the car? She finally finds the car. She gets the kids over there and she puts the five-year-old in. And the five-year-old knows how to strap in her seatbelt, but the two-year-old still has to get into the car seat, and she has to put her in and strap her in like she's going to Mars. Okay, and then, like, she doesn't have a car seat for the baby, you know? And Melissa's a good, yuppie Manhattan mom. She knows you can't put a kid in the car without a car seat, right? So then she sort of has to fashion one out of a crate or a laundry basket and put in the DVD and make sure that the Disney radio is on and give everybody their snacks and a little bit of water. And then she has to put her own seatbelt on and gun that car across state lines. And that's how she could have stolen this other lady's baby. So my whole question for you today is going to be, who's crazy in our society? The people who think, here's another mom, it's a public place, I can take my eyes off my kid for a couple of minutes, it's not the end of the world. Or the people who think that the minute you're not watching your kid, that kid is going to be snatched by the closest person to them. Well, I wrote a column about that because I used to write for the Daily News. Does anybody remember when I was in the Daily News? Any Daily News readers here? Yay, one! This is addressed to you, right? Before they fired me. Anyways, another story. We won't get into it. Arthur Brown, the head of the Op-Ed page. But anyways, I wrote a column, and I thought, this is going to set the world on fire. This is showing how weird a society we're living in that's so paranoid that nothing is safe enough. And I got 3 emails. Two were saying, like, you sound like a very bad mom, maybe the worst mom in America. And then one was from my elderly admirer on Staten Island, maybe he's here today, who would write to me no matter what I wrote. And he wrote, you're not crazy, but I'm crazy for Skenazy, which is me. So I was like, I always appreciated him, even though that didn't make any sense. So that was that. I continued writing columns. I got fired. I ended up at another paper. And a couple years later, as you heard from Emily, our 9-year-old son, we have 2 sons, one who never gets mentioned, who's 2 years older than the 9-year-old, and then our 9-year-old son, Izzy, who had been asking at that time, 4th grade, would we please take him somewhere and let him find his own way home on the subway? This was his heart's desire. And my husband and I thought, I don't know, should we let him do this? We, you know, our older son hadn't asked to do this. And we thought, well, we're on the subways all the time, and we, you know, he knows the way it works. My husband sat down with him on the floor with the subway map to make sure he understood, although today I ended up at Franklin Avenue from Queens. But anyways, he could understand where he was going. And then one sunny Sunday, I took him to Bloomingdale's, the 59th Street Bloomingdale's. And I said, okay, today's the day, hon. He was really excited. And I left him in the handbag department, mostly because it sounded like a children's story. I left. What's that, huh? Left him in the handbag department. Yes, she did. What a terrible mom. But I knew that the handbag department, you open the doors and there's the subway, right? I'm so happy to be talking to a New York audience because when I talk to other places in the world, they think, you know, there's the pit and the fire is coming out and there's the guy with the pitchfork. And it's like, that's not what the subway is. It's how we get around. So sure enough, he went down and he asked a man for directions, a stranger that he didn't know. And the man said, you'll be perfect for Melissa. No. The man said uptown is there, but you want to go downtown. And so he took the train downtown to 34th Street. He took what's always the slowest bus in the city, the 34th Street bus across town to our apartment building. And he got there 45 minutes later, proud. Proud and happy. And me, with my keen nose for news, I hear somebody rustling, right? This fits in with the subway scenario. There's always somebody lurking, right? Hello. Don't abduct me. So we got he got home, he was happy, and I didn't write about it because it wasn't a publicity scheme. It wasn't even a big milestone. It was just something that made him happy, and it was just part of our everyday life. Until like a month later when I didn't have anything to write about, and the deadline was staring me in the face, I said to my editor, I don't know, maybe I'll write about Izzy's subway ride. I've talked to some of the other fourth grade parents. They think it's a little early to be riding the subway alone. And my editor said, that sounds like a nice local story. Local. That night, the phone rang, and this probably doesn't happen to you often. I picked it up, and who was there? The Howard Stern Show. Okay, and I'm like, the who? Who is interested? Why are you calling me? You know, quit breathing like that. What is going on? And I was thinking, you know, this is Lenore Skenazy. It might be an odd name, but it's not a stripper name. It's actually my given name. And it turned out that it was Joey Boots. You guys know Joey Boots? Somebody in the back is going to know Joey Boots. Joey Boots from the Stern Show is interested in this subway story. Okay. Okay. Yeah, feel free to call back. Not so late at night. And then, put it down, and the phone rang again, and it was the Today Show. And I'm thinking, that's kind of weird. You know, I mean, I'm sure this happens to the Kardashians, but it doesn't happen a lot in my home. So Howard ended up not doing a story. So what happened is I went on the Today Show, and after that I was on MSNBC, Fox News, and NPR in rapid succession, defending myself as not a terrible mom. But when I was on the NPR show, it was a call-in show, and one guy called up, and he wanted to know why that woman, like he was Clinton, that woman had given her son one fun day of frolicking in the subway when he would probably end up raped, murdered, thrown on the tracks, and set on fire when she, this pimp here, could have given him a long and happy life. And I'm thinking, this is a question? It's like, well, you know, six of one, half a dozen of the other, you know, murdered, raped, set on fire versus long and happy life. You know, I have a spare son at home. I need column material. Obviously, I did it without a thought to whether he would be safe or even survive the end of the day. The fact that people were thinking about me that way made me start my website that weekend. And thank God I have a techie husband who, you know, set it up on WordPress, and there I was starting the blog Free Range Kids, which states very simply that I love my children and I love safety. I love helmets. I love car seats. I love seat belts. When the 9-year-old turned 10 and it was his football birthday party, before anybody could play, I made them come to me and I personally boiled each protective mouth guard in the hot water for 3 minutes, then blew on it so it wouldn't hurt anybody, and then fit it to their teeth so that everybody would be safe just playing a game of tag football in our courtyard. So I love safety, and if I'm considered radical and wild and Evel Knievel-esque, what's going on there? Well, that's when I found out. We live in New York, so you might not know this, but did you know that like only 11% of kids walk to school themselves anymore? Did you know that? That's 1 out of 10, right? So what happens? In a lot of communities, parents drive their children to the bus stop. I didn't know that. I started hearing these things from the website. And not only do they drive them to the website, they don't just to the bus stop, they don't just drop them off. They wait there to make sure the child gets on the bus safely. And only when that has successfully happened do they continue on their way. And then there are communities throughout the country where people don't just drive to the bus stop. The bus actually stops at each individual house to make it safer so that the kids don't have to wait at a bus stop. And what do the parents there do? Do you know what they do? They drive their children from the garage to the sidewalk, right? Because that way they're sure nobody has come and got them. They haven't gotten too hot. They haven't gotten too cold. They're not bored. There's SpongeBob on the DVD player. And then I heard about what happens in schools across the country at pickup time. And I know you don't know this because you live here and you're in, you know, what everybody else considers a weird place, Brooklyn, that I consider a pretty normal place. But what happens in the rest of the country in many schools is that after school, the kids are divided up. And the ones who are going home on the bus, the ones nobody cares about, the parents don't care, they're sending them on the bus, they go off to the bus. And maybe a trickle walk home if the school allows it. Many schools don't. But the rest are huddled in the gym or in the cafeteria awaiting word. And what is the word they're awaiting? They're waiting for their parents who are lining up half an hour ahead of time outside the front door of the school until bring, it's 3:30. Okay, and then the first car drives up. And then there's somebody out there from the school with a walkie-talkie who reads the name on the dashboard, and it's Michael. And she radios down to the gym. Okay, Michael G's mom is here. Michael G's mom. And in the gym, they're like, Michael, Michael, your mom is here. No, Michael G. Michael G, your mom is here. Picks up Michael, brings him to the door. Somebody gets him at the door. He's escorted. Somebody opens the door. He's shoved in like Obama. And then off goes Michael's mom. And then up comes, okay, it's Jaden's mom. Jaden. Okay, Jaden. It's Cindy's mom. Cindy. And all that's missing is like helicopters overhead. Thunk, 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 thunk. Bombs exploding. Flares going up. It's the fall of Saigon every day in suburban school systems around the country. And when you think about it, these are parents who move to the suburbs. Why? To be safe. To give their kids a nice, safe childhood. The fact that nobody thinks that their neighborhood is safe, the people who got to choose where they live, is amazing to me. And that's just the fear of predators. The fear is in every nook and cranny of childhood. I heard of a Boy Scout troop, a Cub Scout troop, where the Cub Scout leader shows the kids, the boys, how to whittle. How do you whittle? You take a piece of wood and you take a knife, which is exactly what he showed him. This is how you whittle. And then he gave each child, after he demonstrated this ancient technique, what? A knife! Are you kidding? You're living back in the old days, sir. He gave them each a potato peeler. Right? Can you imagine the Native Americans with a potato peeler trying to make like a totem pole? We would have like these little things. We'd have chopsticks instead. It's just a crazy disbelief that our children can handle anything, even a penknife. Girl Scouts are not immune. When they're still allowed to toast marshmallows, but they have to do it like this. One knee on the ground. Why? Because otherwise, they were just immolating themselves. You know, it's that Joan of Arc troop is 85. Everybody's worried that they were falling into the fire. Can you handle a marshmallow over a fire? Do you think you could? Could you have done it, I don't know, 8 years ago? Say yes. Say yes for my sake. Say yes. You handled marshmallows, right? You can handle a marshmallow over a flame without dying. And you ate them too. Oh my God, you didn't burn your mouth. Wow. Take out your mouth guard. So this was surprising to me to find out that fear was everywhere. And I'm middle-aged, and at middle age, and then even into seniorhood, we do have a tendency to say, oh, but things were so much better and freer and different back then. So I wanted to make sure it wasn't just my perception that things seem insanely fearful these days. And then I found the smoking gun that proves that it's not just me. And this is why someday I will figure out PowerPoint and show it to you for real. But if you get the DVD, the two DVD set of Sesame Street called Sesame Street Old School, it's highlights of Sesame Street from 69 to 74, which are the first 5 years it was on air. And it shows things like kids playing Follow the Leader, and the leader is not a PhD student in Follow the Leader studies. It's actually like another six-year-old, right? It's six-year-olds following each other around. Then there are kids playing in an empty lot, a vacant lot, which I would guess that some of you played in, right, as kids. And there's, you know, they're balancing on a piece of wood, and they climb through one of those big tunnels, like big pipes on the ground, and there's no homeless person in the middle. It's a straight shot through to the end. And they're having a ball, and before you see any of these sort of halcyon pictures of childhood, a warning appears on screen at the very beginning of the DVD. And it says, the following is intended for adult viewing only and may not be suitable for young children. Sesame Street, yes, thank you. Sesame Street. I mean, I could tell you stories. Sesame Street keeps redoing its old classic videos. There was one where they had to look for their lost dog, and it used to be two kids looking for the dog. And when they remade it, it was two kids, the mom and this baby sister, looking for the dog. They couldn't endorse the idea of children doing anything on their own. And my friend is a lawyer at Sesame Street. And I said to him, what's going on? Didn't you guys feel foolish? And he said, yeah, they had a lot of discussions, but in the end, they were afraid. They were afraid for children. They were afraid for liability reasons. They simply couldn't endorse anything of a free-range childhood. Let's put it that way. So what I decided to do when I was writing my book is figure out why. How did we get so afraid? And now I will look at my watch and figure out how quickly I have to go through these. Really fast, right? Well, I have four. There's four things that are different now than when my parents were raising me, certainly when your parents were raising you, and possibly, how old are you guys? So you were 10 years ago. No, like 12 years ago. All right, it might have changed even since then. The biggest difference and the thing that we always blame, like knee-jerk blame, is the media. And there's a reason, because the media deserve a lot of blame. When my parents were bringing me up, they turned on the news, and then it stopped. After half an hour, somebody said goodnight, and that was it. But now there's 24-hour news. What story can keep you glued to the screen for hours, weeks, months? What kind of story? An abduction. An abduction. That's why we know the names Kaylee, right? Maddie McCann, JC Dugard, which I always thought proves that, like, don't name your children with two E's at the end of their name, just a word of warning. But the point is that these stories are repeated over and over again. The other day, the View ladies were talking about me again, and one of them was saying how crazy I was. It was Barbara. And she said, what about Eitan Patz? Why isn't she thinking about Eitan Patz? It's like, why are we thinking of Eitan Patz? Eitan Patz is a tragic story. He was abducted from a bus stop 33 years ago and never seen again. But to reference the weirdest, worst stories all the time and use them as opposed to thinking about, wow, there's been an entire generation and a half since Eitan, shows that we can only, when our brains are trying to figure out whether something is safe, we pull up the files and we're like Google, we pull up the pictures. We have a picture in our mind of Eitan Patz. We have a picture of JC Dugard and Elizabeth Smart. And we think, like Google, those are the most relevant to our search, but actually those are the most irrelevant because they're so unusual that they pop up, whereas the millions of faceless kids who have gone to school and gotten there safely and come back home and had their snacks do not pop up. So with the media keeping these stories in our brains and showing us the home movies, I got to Australia, I turned on my TV, and I had seen the footage. It was JC Dugard making Christmas cookies with her mom after reuniting after the 18 years. It's like, that's not even... That was far from us, you know, it happened in California, but from Australia, it was 15,000 miles. But somehow this is put in front of us as if it's relevant to our child-rearing decisions. So the media makes us very scared on the news and Nancy Grace. And I have to tell you, whenever I'm on CNN, they put it, it's me and the parent of somebody who was murdered. It's happened, I think, two or three times now. So the idea that anybody could assert, like, this is what I want to say. Do you have today's, anyone who has today's AM New York? Wait, before you pull out AM New York, somebody has to have AM New York. Tell me, how's the crime rate? Yeah, you read. You know, you're old school, you're reading the newspaper. What can I say? I love you. Right? Right. Plunge in murder rate. Right, even plunge makes it sound scary. But and then they do show you like a little outline of a victim. And even when they're reporting this wonderful news, this 18% murders down, they said, while the city has seen a continuous drop in homicides, don't forget there was a four-year-old who was slain and there were three people who this. It's like you can never, this story will be a story for one day. But last week's New York Post had City of Fear on the cover, and that's really what sells. So you hear so much about crime going up that most people in America, when you poll them in the 70%, think that crime is going up, even though we are down right now to a crime rate that existed before color TV. So we're living in pretty safe times, and when people say, oh, I'd love to let my kid outside, but not anymore, you know, we're living in really, really different times, I'm like, yeah, we're living in way safer times than like the crack epidemic of the 70s or the 80s or the 90s. Crime is down from when my generation, the parent generation, when we were kids, allowed outside. So the media exists to scare you because that keeps you viewing. We live in the litigious society. That's the other one of the other factors that is making us more scared, because people are afraid of being sued, schools are afraid of being sued, companies are afraid of being sued. They suck things out of childhood, just like that Sesame Street video, you know, don't watch it, you know, it's really not intended for you kids. There are park districts around the country who have taken out merry-go-rounds. Because why? A kid could fall off a merry-go-round. Yeah, have you seen a merry-go-round in your life? Have you seen a merry-go-round that you jump on and go around? No. No? Right. Well, nobody would make you go on. Actually, I was going to tell you, the other thing they took out is teeter-totters. And I must say, I've always been this little stick of a person. And I was always up there going, let me down, let me down. So in a way, I was happy. But teeter-totters are gone now. Slides are shorter. Everything has been made safer because of this fear of being sued. Little Tykes does a little workbench for kids, you know, and it's plastic, and it's been around since the 90s. And then 2 years ago, a little kid almost choked on a nail. And I thought, well, why are they putting nails in this plastic workbench? That's stupid. You know, they should do something else. But then I read about it, and the nail that in question was this big. It was made out of plastic. It was practically the size of your coffee cup. It was really the size of a salt shaker. And because this one kid had almost choked on it, suddenly Little Tykes recalled all 1.5 million of its Little Tykes, whatever it's a workbench set, 1.5 million, and it had been sold since 95. So if you ask me, something that has been sold over a million of, and it's been around for almost an entire generation, and even the choker didn't choke to death, to me, that's a safe product. That's a product you could have in your house with a lot of confidence. But in today's litigious society, Little Tykes had to dissociate itself with it, tell everybody to return all the nails, cease using them immediately. And so we start looking at everything through the lens of, how is this dangerous? You know, is there BPA in here? Is this going to give you a paper cut? Could you fall off that chair? You probably could. So when you start looking at life like a lawyer, nothing seems safe enough. They recall every possible child's clothing that has a toggle on it. Did you know that? And the most recent one I read is like, it could get caught in a trunk. And I'm thinking, you know, by the time your kid's in the trunk, isn't that a bigger problem than the toggle? But that's the kind of over-cautiousness and weird thinking that goes into a lawyer's mind and that filters down to us. A third thing that is making us feel so afraid these days for our children is simply the expert culture. And I should have brought you this month's parenting magazine. I get the parenting magazines just to laugh and rant and tear my hair out. That's why it's thin, not because I'm getting old. Like this month, it had an article on how to hug your child. I swear to God. It's like, make it chest to chest, hold them for at least 3 seconds, like catch and release. Then what do I do? Do I go to work this way? You know, no, then you let them go, and you let them know, and say something affirmative, like, I hate you, you stupid one. No, that's wrong. Say, I love you. I mean, they treat parents like idiots who can't possibly figure out anything on their own, and if they're not instructed, they will get it wrong. And it starts with the What to Expect books. I don't know if any of you are in the generation that was tyrannized by the What to Expect book, but it's the book. It started out 300 pages, then the next edition was 400, 500, 600, now with more symptoms than ever. Woo! That's great, because I thought it was just like my toe hurt. No, it's early diabetes gestational disaster. I mean, everything is catastrophized. There's 27 pages on how you're supposed to eat. And let me just read to you from my quote from this book. So what do you get if you eat? And it's not like try to eat well or eat some spinach or, you know, maybe no more Kahlua milkshakes for a couple months. It's not that. It says you're supposed to feed your baby each bite for 9 months. Each single bite that is going into your mouth had better be optimal. Why? Quote, each bite during the day is an opportunity to feed that growing baby of yours healthy nutrients. And what do you get? Better birth weight, improved brain development, lower risk for certain birth defects, dot, dot, dot. So what are they saying? Something goes wrong with your kid? It's that time you ate the cupcake instead of the quinoa? It's It's so evil, it reminds me of when Henry VIII had Anne Boleyn beheaded because she had a child with birth defects. It was her fault. Let's get rid of her. And this is these are these nice Upper West Side moms who are telling you, if you eat every single bite for 9 whole months correctly, you'll have an okay, perhaps even Harvard-bound child. And if not, all bets are off, and guess who did it? You, because you weren't perfect. Dr. Oz, even if you get Dr. Oz, Dr. Oz hasn't been pregnant, but he wrote this big pregnancy book, and one of the suggestions he says is to be a really good parent and to give your kid the leg up or the kick up, because it's in while you're pregnant, read stories to them. I mean, what are they hearing? You're reading them the Three Little Pigs. How good are you at listening to stories when you're underwater and under a raft underwater? I mean, it's so ridiculous, but the idea is this ramp up, like perfect, 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 and it drives you nuts. So that makes us scared that maybe we're doing something wrong for our children. But my favorite and last reason that we're so scared is simply what I call the child safety industrial complex, and I brought some examples. No, that's Kleenex. That's for me. These are my samples. What are these? Anybody? Let's ask the seniors first, because you guys might
act.
Leg warmers. That's like 1980s, you know, Olivia Newton-John. No.
No?
No, absolutely not. I mean, I guess they'll keep your leg warm, but that's not the point. Aren't they kind of tiny? No, they're not for the hands. They're for somebody younger than you. They're baby knee pads! These are baby knee pads that you put on your baby when she's learning to crawl because you decorated the nursery in crushed glass, which was a bad idea, but it looked so sparkly. No, the idea is that suddenly kids are not built to survive crawling unless you buy this stupid doodad from the horrible people at One Step Ahead. That's crazy, but suddenly the fact that they exist makes you think, oh, maybe it is too harsh. One mom on the website reviewing these said, it's really great because it helped my daughter transition from the floor to the carpet. Yeah, those difficult transitions that no child can make without a little assistance. Okay, what's these? Wait. What are these? These are table toppers made by our friends at Disney who would never like make anything excessive or unnecessary. They're disposable placemats. Okay, and it says they are eco-friendly, except for the fact that they exist. Product and package. What do you use these for? Well, they provide, quote, I'm reading, right? On-the-go protection from germs, dirt, and cleaning chemicals on restaurant and food court tables. Wait a minute. So my child is in danger if, like, you know, the sub-minimum wage help there has not, like, scraped off the tamales from 4 days ago. That's the germs and dirt. But God forbid somebody came through and cleaned the table. My kid is in danger from the cleaning chemicals. So my kid is, let's see, always in danger. And I always need a new product, and I always need to be worried about something. If I'm going out to eat, something is going to kill my child, either the berry left on there from the people who ate before me, or some horrible non-organic, non-seventh generation green thing that somebody cleaned the tables for. But this is my very favorite. This, who knows what this is? A rubber duck. Oh, I love having seniors here. You remember the days of a rubber duck. Rubber ducks are nice. This duck is out to screw you, okay? This is the baby bathwater temperature duck. Water temperature. You put it in your baby's bath, and then you wait a few minutes, and you turn it upside down, and if the word hot appears on the bottom of this duck, then, and only then, do you know that the water is too hot for you to put your baby in. Because I don't suppose you could, like, put your hand in there, and if you pulled it out, and all that's left are, like, bones, and the flesh is sort of swimming around there and it smells like chicken soup, you know, maybe that's a little hot and I should wait. But this duck is telling you that it knows better than you. But please read aloud. Who wants to read aloud? You? Can you read? Right. I meant without glasses, and then I thought that sounded bad, but can you read sounds worse. So I know you can read. Just read right that one sentence that starts with adult.
Adults should always place hand in bath water to test the temperature before placing baby in tub.
Wait a minute. So what is this doing? You know what this is doing? This is screwing you out of like $3.99. There's shelf after shelf of them at Babies R Us, and it's undermining your confidence. It's telling you that as a parent, your baby is in danger from your own stupidity, from your own house, from every germ, from every time you leave the house. There's nothing you can do. You better buy something, take something, read something, do something, and worry a lot, or your kid won't make it to the next day. So that's why we are so worried as parents. And because I am worried about time, I'm going to skip right to what's the antidote. Because the problem we see kids who are diabetic, overweight, sad, locked inside, never allowed to do anything on their own, quote unquote, for their own good. But in fact, if the world is safer than when we parents were children, and if it is good to have experiences and be out in the sunshine and have adventures and maybe even get lost sometimes, there's something good about letting our kids go back and have an old-fashioned childhood. So how do you do that? One teacher at the Nest School on East Houston, she teaches sixth grade, has done a project now for a couple of years called Free Range Project. The kids, she read the article about Izzy going on the subway, and she thought, well, these kids are 11 in sixth grade. Let me tell them that they can do anything that they want, that their parents approve of, that they haven't done yet, that they feel they're ready for. And then they have to write a little article about it or a poster or whatever. And a bunch of the projects, I go in every year and I read them, and some of them are always so dishearteningly ridiculously pathetic. What can I say? Like, a couple of kids each year fry an egg. Woo! You know? And one girl wrote a whole booklet about it, and she said, I was so scared. I thought I was going to burn down the house. It's like, wow, and you're at Nest? Wow, and my kid couldn't get in Nest, but you got in. But anyway, and then there are kids who do. One kid wanted to, she lives in Battery Park, and it's she asked her mom, you know, very safe Battery Park, can I knock on the doors of the other kids, the other apartments on the floor to meet our neighbors? And the mother said, no, are you crazy? No, no. And the child was very smart. She said, but mom, what if there's ever a fire? Don't you want them to know that I'm here? And the mother was like, oh my God, there's predators, but there's a fire, and there's predators, and there's a fire. It's like she had to decide. And then mom said, but mom, it's extra credit. Okay. So she let the girl knock on all the doors, and because the girl is going to a magnet school, she doesn't go to school in the neighborhood, and what did she find? Two other girls her age on the floor. She met two friends, which is what my whole free-range kids movement is about. It's about connecting. It's about community. But my favorite story is a girl who decided to bake an independence cake. And she wrote a big poster, how to bake an independence cake. She's not that good at spacing. But what she decided to do was take her own money and walk to the store. She lives in the East, like East Houston, East Village. And go to the store by herself, buy all the ingredients to make a cake from scratch, come home and make it. So she started out one day, her money in her pocket, and what she wrote in her little essay was, quote, here's the quote. On the way there, everyone looked angry, like they were going to reach out and snatch me. It was no spring picnic. Okay? It was a scary thing for her because what does she know about the outside world? Only what she's seen on TV and seen in the papers and heard from other people and friends and stranger danger lectures at school is scary. But she got to the market and she went up and down all the aisles and she got the flour and the sugar and the eggs and butter and she's waiting in line to check out and somebody says, excuse me, would you watch my child? No. This is the infinite loop lecture. No, nobody asked her to watch their baby. She gets to the front, she pays, and she's leaving with her packages. She's paid with her own money, and she wrote that after that, quote, the way home seemed so much shorter and more pleasant because I was already used to the walk. And that's what I'm asking you to think about today. You, as you grow up and have families, you as you, you know, see your grandchildren or whatever raised, is to remember that childhood is about that, about experiencing the world, about making it your own. That kid now has the world as her oyster. She can go out there. She's not afraid. The more confident you are, the safer you are anyway. And it's all because she's starting to have a free-range childhood. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Questions? Does anyone have any questions? Students, senior citizens?
Oh, I should have told you this. I've had very positive response. You know, the fact that the blog is going on 4 years later and the book, and people write to me every day, and I'm really grateful to have, first of all, people who tell me their little stories. Like, I was really afraid, but I read your book, and so now I started letting my 7-year-old walk to school, and darned if the neighbor didn't say, oh, can my daughter walk to school with her? And that's breaking the ice. I desperately just want to put children back outside. And when I hear about those things, yes, it is very positive. And I'm also, I think, a support system for people who run afoul of the mainstream and who are like, gee, I was just letting my kids play outside today and some lady yelled at me that aren't I worried about them being kidnapped. And it's like, I'm not worried about them being kidnapped. And I want to push back on, there's just so many encroachments. Like a lot of schools now, you can't even be the mom who brings in the cupcakes, not in Bloomberg's New York, the mom who brings in the carrot sticks without getting a background check. And that's keeping parents from volunteering. Sometimes they have to pay for the check themselves. Sometimes they don't want to be checked. It's like, I'm not going there to be a pedophile or to groom a child. One mom couldn't get into her daughter's Christmas kindergarten party because her background check hadn't cleared yet. And she begged and begged at the front desk. And finally, the compromise was this. She could go to the kindergarten Christmas party so long as she stayed in the back and did not interact with any children. So when you get that kind of paranoia level where you're seeing every single person as a threat to children, that causes a breakdown in society. Everybody's staying inside and everybody's afraid of everyone else. Everybody wants everybody arrested for child endangerment. And it's obviously not good. Not good for any generation. Yes?
You never want to pull out.
Yes, yes. It's not all that the parents are keeping them inside. And I know because I'm always the free-range mom. I'm trying to get them off the computer. The technology has two different roles in the way we're raising our kids now. One is that, yes, there's always somebody who's happy to play exactly what game your kid wants to play, and it's called the computer, and it won't complain when you cheat or when you stop in the middle when you're losing. So there's that problem. And then there's also when we have cell phones, it's so easy to keep checking in and to keep track and to GPS and to watch over our kids, like the Harry Potter, that Marauder's map, that we get used to never really separating from our kids. And then the idea that you could actually have your kid, I mean, one of the reasons the Izzy story about the subway was such a big deal is I didn't give him a cell phone because I had every confidence that he would get home, and I was pretty sure the cell phone wouldn't. And so people said, oh, you must love the cell phone more. And it's like, no, I think kids can be okay even without constant contact. But that's being whittled away now. There's so many products out there for GPSing your kid. And if we have more time, I'll tell you about the loathsome Verizon ad. So either people can ask a question or the loathsome Verizon ad. Yes? Well, that's the other thing, too. If you don't ever have any, it's like, you know, if you're raised in a bubble, how do you know that there's life outside the bubble? What upsets me about that is obviously I think a lot of us had parents and grandparents or even us, who crossed an ocean at 15 or 16 and started an entire new life in an entire new country with an entire new language and, you know, 50 kopecks in their pocket. And now to say that, you know, your brilliant son, who's obviously a good kid, can't get on a train for 30 minutes, it's selling the kids short, even though we think we're doing the best for them. But the message they're getting is, oh, I can't do that. I need my mom or I'll be in danger. Right, I totally agree. And one of the things that I should emphasize is that free-range kids is not freewheeling kids. I don't know where they are. I don't care if they come home. You know, they can shoot their own dinner. It's training our kids the way our parents trained us, because our parents knew that it was not perfectly safe out there either. But they had a grip, and they knew that part of their job was, there's that expression, you can't always prepare the path for your child, so prepare your child for the path. So they start out by teaching you to cross the street safely. They tell you that you can talk to strangers, you can never go off with a stranger. If you need help, you can ask, but don't go off with somebody who's saying, I have candy or I'm missing my puppy. They teach you how to swim. I mean, we really do have to prepare our kids. That's our job, but you're not preparing your kid if you don't even let them go on the subway and maybe even get lost once in a while. And in terms of people are very worried about molesting, and what I teach my kids is what I've heard the Boy Scouts teach kids, and I think in churches too. It's to recognize, resist, and report abuse, because those are the three things that will keep your kids and your grandkids safer than anything else, because you can't vet every individual who's ever going to come close to them, although that's what we're trying to do now with the schools. So recognize nobody can touch you where your bathing suit covers, right? That's just, it's simple. You can teach it to a three-year-old, just like you teach them to stop, drop, and roll if they're on fire. Resist. If you resist, you know, you're already ahead of the game. A lot of people will just desist. And then report. Leave the lines of communication open between you and your kids, so that if something weird happens or they feel funny about something, they don't feel guilty like it's their fault. They can come and talk to you and you won't be mad. Tell them you won't be mad. So that you remove the shame as much as possible and you keep those lines open. And that's as safe as you can possibly make a kid, because you're not going to know if it's, you know, 90% of abuse occurs with somebody that the kids know very well, not a stranger. And so you never know who it could be. And it probably won't be anyone, but if it is, arm them with the three R's: recognize, resist, and report abuse. And I think that is being safe. But our parents knew, you know, to teach us those things and then let us out, as opposed to thinking that it was their job to have their eyes on us 24/7 until college. You know, I've been asked that so much. The question was, when I let my son go on the subway, was there a moment of fear or paranoia? And there was the feeling of, like, this is a step, a big step towards a new phase for Izzy, sort of like when you drop your kid off at kindergarten. But if I felt it was something truly dangerous, if I felt it was a dangerous subway stop, a dangerous time of day, I wouldn't have done it, because I don't want my kid to be in danger. Yeah, I didn't have any idea I was a free-range mom. All I'd written was that one story about Melissa, and it sort of had, you know, been in my brain, sort of tickling it for years. But, yeah, I didn't know I was free-range until I saw, first of all, that everybody else was, like, driving their kids to the bus stop. That was so strange, because I grew up in the suburbs of Chicago, and we walked to the bus stop, and that was, like, a clear difference. And then also, I did spend 14 years at the Daily News as a reporter, going around, features reporter, doing a lot of food stories, actually. And I would go to all sorts of neighborhoods, and I think as a reporter, I had a sort of better, a more clear view of reality, because I had experienced so much, particularly in the city, that I didn't think my mind was as clouded with the fear of the worst case scenario, since I had been in so many neighborhoods and people had been really nice and showing me how to make sorrel or rice and beans or all sorts of different things in different neighborhoods. And so between trusting the world and doing my actual research, yeah, then I finally realized I guess I am free range. And then that's the term we came up with, me and my husband. Yeah, I would love it if there was, and actually I do think there is, like, a book. I mean, I like Dr. Spock. I mean, I agree, you're right. I shouldn't be totally laughing. It is good to know, like, at 6 months they're ready for rice or whatever it is, those kind of things. But the parenting magazines have to come out with something every month to fill their pages. And so they fill it with, like, how to have a toy, and they have to sell things, right? So, like, when I started reading the magazines skeptically, there was one article, it was 4 pages, how to have a fun and totally safe day in the sun with your kids. And I was thinking, do you really need 4 pages of instruction? You know, it said choose a sunny day when there's no threat of a thunderstorm. And I'm like, you mean like if that cloud is looks sort of like the drain is coming towards me and there's like a roof in the air, then I shouldn't take my kid out? I mean, I don't like the way they treat us like idiots, like here's how to hug your child. Like people who have almost autism, like here's how to be in the world. And then the thing about the 4 pages on how to have a fun day in the sun that's safe, well, it's not like you can just take your kid out and play at the park. It's you need a $700 stroller, you need a sandwich cooler, you need specific SPF, you need a sun hat, you need bug off, you need Bactine new nasal spray foot massage, whatever it is. They just come up with like so many expensive things. There was an article I did, an article I read this summer that I wrote about that was how to help your kid have a lemonade stand, and I was thinking like, you know, do I need an article on this? And by the time you added up the ice cube trays and the pitcher and the stand that they suggested you buy from Toys R Us and the straws and the chalk and the poster board, and I can't even remember what else they came up with, it was $280 worth of things that you needed to buy for your kid to have a lemonade stand. It didn't include the lemons, right? So I am very skeptical when I'm reading these magazines because I feel like maybe the editors do wish that they could just give some tips to parents, some good advice, but they lard it with products and with making you worry that if you don't do it right, something terrible will happen. I think I can take my kid out for a day in the sun and I don't need four pages. But maybe I should be told that, you know, it's better for the kid to have a hat. So I agree that there's some things that parents don't know. And I would sort of hope that maybe they would learn it from other parents or their own parents. You know, I'm not against all advice, but I am against this tsunami of advice that just flushes over parents on a daily basis. And you know what? It's not, I mean, parents who are not letting their children out don't think of it as stunting their child. Here, let me give you one example. In a lot of school districts around the country, they have auctions to raise money. The PTA raises money. And one of the hot items these days is the drop-off place in front of the school. They raise money that you can bid on getting the prime drop-off space in front of the school for when it's morning drop-off. And I was telling this story once to a school, and I was like, can you believe it? And it was like, theirs had sold for $11,000. So I tried to change the topic really fast. But my point about that is that, okay, so you have that spot in front of a school is like if it was in front of the dentist office or in front of the mall, there's usually a sign and it says, handicapped parking, right? So you have parents vying for the opportunity to treat their child as if he's handicapped. And that's sort of what you're talking about now. You could walk three blocks to school, and other parents thought, oh no, it's too dangerous, it's too much to ask, what if it's raining? There's something to be said for a little self-reliance and for parents believing in you and knowing that your mom believes in you. That's a great feeling. I know, okay. I know. And you know, maybe, you know, sometimes there's like, you don't want to have so little fear that like a guy is saying, come into my, you know, windowless white van, you know, the predator's van of choice. So you don't want to have zero fear. I mean, I think it is good to teach your kids those 3 R's we were talking about and to not go off with anybody. But to be constantly afraid is the stage that we're in now, where, like you're saying, the 15-year-old grandson, not only does his mom not trust him to take public transportation, we're not even talking about getting in a, you know, a car with a stranger, we're talking about public transportation with a lot of other people around, and now the 15-year-old is afraid too. And that's what I've started hearing actually when I talk to kids, is like, I don't want to, no, somebody's going to take me. Highlights did a survey, Highlights magazine, you remember Goofus and Gallant, and I wish I had the results with me. I got to ask one of the questions on the survey, so I said, what are your parents worried about? And page after page after, my parents are worried I'm going to be taken. My parents are worried about bad people attacking me. My parents are worried I will be abducted. Mostly my parents worry about me. And it's just this overwhelming fear that really, I'm happy we're living in 2012. Steven Pinker of Harvard University just wrote a book, finding it the safest time in human history. And we're treating it like we're in Nazi Germany and scared to go on the street because we'll be picked up by the Gestapo. And to me, it seems ungrateful. Here we are living, we've conquered diphtheria and polio. There's no famine. The war is not in our country. You know, there's the child mortality rate has plummeted. Even since I was a kid, it was 4 times higher. And we're acting as if it's hell out there. And that's why I just... Free-range kids is all about, it boils down to realizing that our children are safer and smarter than our culture gives them credit for. Don't, because everybody says that, then you have to take, what do I mean when I say there are so many bad things happening? What? Wait, that's what, did you listen to my speech? The kidnappings are very, very, very rare.
I know, but...
And they're not going up.
This is because it's in the paper, but what worries me is what's not in the paper, what's going on?
Well, if you're, you know, I read a great quote the other day, and I'm sure I'll totally mangle it. It's like, you know, if we fear something that we are that we know about and is real, we can do something about it. But fears of things that we imagine or worry might be happening, the what ifs, you can't battle a what if. I mean, you're assuming that the paper is not jumping on horrible stories. I assure you, as a newspaper reporter for 20 years, they jump on the bad stories. You're hearing the bad stories. And you're hearing them over and over again. And sometimes you're hearing them for decades. Right, right. Nobody wants that to happen. But
All I can say is I spoke to another woman who actually I think is 84 this year. And that actually had happened to her as a kid. She said that she and her sister used to play in Riverside Park, and once a guy pulled them, you know, motioned for them to come over. He was in a station wagon. He rolled down the window, and he said, and she said, and to this day, we giggle about it. Now, nobody wants to have this happen to their child or their grandchild or themselves. But the other thing is our response. We've sort of been trained to think of everything as damaging us permanently forever. But I think we're more resilient than that, too. And if that happened to your daughter or granddaughter, I'd feel bad, and I wish it wouldn't have happened. But it can also be just one of those things in life, an imperfect moment, or maybe she could even, at some point, 70 years from now, giggle about it. That's all. That's it.
You'll stay for a minute.
Yeah, I'll stay afterwards if you want to talk.
Okay, thank you so much. I hope you had fun and enjoyed her talk.